satisfied. The taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Hey there, Pastor Dave here with Pilgrim Lutheran Brethren Church. We're so glad you could join us for our online sermon today. This is the third of our four-week sermon series called Place for a Purpose, based on stewardship that Martin Luther discusses as the three estates: the church, the state, and the family. Now, when we think about that, being a steward, what exactly does that mean? Well, here's a couple of definitions that I found. First is a person who manages another's property or financial affairs, one who administers anything as an agent of another or others. The second is a person who is in charge of a household of another, buying or obtaining food, directing the servants. So we can see that a steward basically is somebody who is responsible for what belongs to somebody else. Our first sermon was entitled Vocation, Vocation, Vocation. And while today we may simply think of vocation as work, in the kingdom of God, vocation is a calling, is a station in life assigned by God. In Martin Luther's time, it was common to separate vocations or people's callings into two categories, the sacred and the secular. The sacred callings were things like kings and nobles and priests, and they were considered special or important and actually called by God. But then you have the secular, the more mundane and ordinary things, the farmers, the people, the smiths, the craftsmen. Those people figured that God did not call them to. Those were just ordinary. But Luther was convinced by God's word that every person is called by God to their assigned stations in life, no matter secular or sacred. And every person's calling then is sacred. So the purpose of this series is to explore what it means for the follower of Christ to be a steward in the three spheres of life, in the church, in the home, and in the state. You see, our God uses means. He takes the ordinary stuff of the earth and he uses it for heavenly purposes. God uses means in the church. You see, he takes ordinary water and combines it with his word and gives us the gift of holy baptism. He takes ordinary bread and wine and he feeds us the very body and blood of his son in communion. He takes ordinary men and calls them to be ministers who delivers this gift to his people. He takes ordinary people and calls them to be servants in the church. He uses all of our labor and toil to bring needed care and love to brothers and sisters in need. He uses the ordinary dollars and cents that we place into his hands to extend his kingdom around the world. God also uses means in the state. When it comes to our communities and our neighborhoods, God uses government for our good. He uses politicians, police, and even the votes that you cast to provide a peaceful, secure community where families can flourish, where evildoers are punished, and where those who do well are commended. God also uses means in the family. Ordinary fathers and mothers, husbands and wives, brothers and sisters are used by God to accomplish extraordinary things. God uses fathers to protect and lead the family. He uses mothers to comfort, teach, and nurture the family. God even uses children to teach parents a thing or two about sacrificial love. You know, I've heard it said that God gives us children so that we know how he feels. I'm guessing that means he gives us teenagers so that we know what it's like to make somebody in our own image who pretends that we don't exist. But seriously, Scripture over and over again emphasizes the importance of the family. And God uses the family as a firm foundation on which he builds both a strong church and state. In our modern American culture, there is so much debate over gender roles, and the definition of marriage and family. Well, for us as Christians, perhaps the best place to start is asking the question, whose idea was marriage anyway? Let's go back in time. Let's come with me back in time into Genesis. If you have your Bibles, turn to Genesis 1:26. It says, "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground.'" Did you notice what God said? He said, "Let us." No, God is not identifying as they, them. He identifies as he, him. This us is the image of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Genesis, the very beginning, Genesis 1:1, opens with God the Father creating everything by his word, his Son, Jesus. And the Holy Spirit is there hovering over the waters. The Trinity is visible at the very beginning. And here, that triune God makes mankind to rule over God's creation, to be stewards, to manage God's property, to manage his creation. Look at verse 27. "So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, 'Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over every living creature that moves on the ground. We see some more details about how God created them, male and female, in Genesis 2, verses 18. It says, "The Lord God said, 'It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him.' Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man." God had formed all the animals and Adam, the very first man, out of the ground. But that's not true with woman. The Lord made woman, Eve, different. He made her out of Adam's rib. The theologian Matthew Henry once said, "The woman was made of a rib out of the side of Adam, not out of his head to rule over him, nor out of his feet to be trampled upon by him, but out of his side to be equal with him, under his arm to be protected, and near his heart to be loved." Look at Adam's response in verse 23. "The man said, 'This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That is why man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh.'" Now that phrase, "one flesh," is not just a figure of speech. It describes how marriage is the closest communion that can possibly exist between two people. It is the union of a man and a woman in heart, body, and mind. They are stuck together like glue. This is why man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Jesus taught about this in Matthew chapter 19, verses 1 through 8. It says, "When Jesus had finished saying these things, he left Galilee and went into the region of Judea, to the other side of the Jordan. Large crowds had followed him, and he healed them there. Some Pharisees came to him to test him. They asked, 'Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason?'" Now, if you're not familiar, the Pharisees were the Jewish religious leaders at that time, and Jesus had been challenging their teaching and ultimately their positions in the community. So earlier in chapter 12, they had already begun to plot how to kill Jesus. So let's just say they're not friends. This question that they're asking, though, It was based on a controversy of the day. You see, many rabbis, the religious teachers, were misinterpreting scripture and allowing men to divorce their wives for any reason at all. So look at Jesus' response in verse 4. Jesus says, "Haven't you read that at the beginning, the Creator made them male and female and said, 'For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh.'" Now look what he adds. "Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Jesus points out that not only are the two one flesh, but the reason that they are one flesh is because it is God who has joined them. They are stuck together like glue. Has anyone ever used rubber cement? When I was doing art, that was our preferred medium for sticking two pieces of paper together. If you've never used it before, it comes in a little jar, it's got a brush in it, and you take this kind of gooey stuff out and you spread it over both pieces of paper and you let it completely dry. And once it's dry, you take those two pieces of paper and you stick them together. They are now one piece of paper. If you try and separate this now one piece of paper, it's going to be a mess. They will absolutely tear each other apart. Part of this paper will be on this paper. Part of this paper will be on this paper. It is a disaster. One day, when I was using rubber cement, the container actually broke when I was trying to open it, and I had rubber cement all over my hands. And so I'm thinking, well, I need to get this off. Well, I don't want to use paper towel because I know what that does. I'll just wash them underwater. So I rushed to the sink and I turned the water on and I start rubbing my hands together. And guess what? Apparently rubber cement doesn't need air to cure, because all of a sudden my hands were stuck together. And this was right before church. So I'm thinking, what am I going to do? Well, luckily I was able to get my hands apart. But you know what? That's not God's intention for marriage. During Jesus' time, these false teachers were allowing men to divorce their wives for any reason, the stupidest reasons. Now, you may have noticed that there is no talk about women divorcing men. And that's because at that time, women couldn't sign legal contracts. And they had no financial status without a male representative. Now, let's fast forward to today. Now, depending on what study you look at, somewhere between 40 and 50% of marriages end in divorce today. And now 70% of those marriages are initiated by women. One of the leading causes for divorce is infidelity. And one study estimates that 1 in 7 divorces are caused by infidelity that results from social media. Another leading cause would be finances, and another, arguing. Now, I started looking at the arguing thing. When you start looking at, well, what are they arguing about? What's the leading cause of arguing that leads to divorce? Guess what? It's finances. And that's why we think it's so important to offer Financial Peace University here at Pilgrim. Learning to be good stewards of the finances that God gives you is also a good way to be a good steward of your family. It helps to maintain what God has joined together. But you know what? God's word offers some other practical advice in Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. It says, "Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord." Now, what's going on in your heart right now? You know, there's been a lot of history in the church surrounding this scripture, and it's all about it being misused to oppress and abuse women. Some men and leaders have misused it in an attempt to control women. And this has caused resentment and hatred of the church by those who have been victimized. But I want you to know that it was used out of context. Let's put it back in context. Let's back up one verse. Look at verse 21. This actually opens with, "Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ." Paul is talking to wives, but he's also talking to husbands too. He's telling both sexes to submit to each other out of respect for Jesus. Now we see 22, "Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord." But look at 23, "For the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything." You know, I was once told that being the head doesn't mean that you boss everybody around. Being the head means whose head is going to roll if things do not go right. And ladies, if your husband is watching over you and caring for you the way that Christ watches over and cares for the church, should you fear submitting to him? Look at verse 25. "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any blemish, but holy and blameless." How did Christ love the church? He was willing to die for her. He gave himself up for her. Husbands, how should you be loving your wives? Just as Christ loved the church. Again, ladies, if your husband loves you the way that Christ loves the church, should you be in fear? No, because he would be submitting to you too. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Look at verse 28. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his mother and father and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself. And the wife must respect her husband. Men, if you have been called to the vocation of a husband, God has called you to be a good steward of the wife that he has gifted you with, to care for her, to nurture her, to present her to God better than when he gave her to you. And ladies, if you have been called to the vocation of wife, God has called you to be a good steward of the husband that he has gifted you with, to be a suitable helper for him. Because Lord knows, we men need a lot of help. God has joined the two of you, and the two are one flesh. This union of man and wife is the foundation of the family. A family that will hopefully produce children that will also one day leave their father and mother and become one flesh with their spouse. This means that the family then is actually the foundation of a strong church, a strong community. It is in the family that children learn their true nature, that they were created in the image of God. It is where they are to learn to be a steward in the three spheres of life, in the church, in the home, and in the state. God doesn't leave us guessing when it comes to the roles and responsibilities of both parents and children. God gave us his will in the form of the law. And the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments are broken into two tables. The first table is made up of the first three commandments. This table shows us how to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. The second table now shows us how we should love our neighbors as ourselves. And what is the very first commandment on the second table? Look at Exodus 20, verse 12. Honor your father and mother so that you may live long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. It's so important that God repeats it in Deuteronomy 5:16. He says, honor your father and mother as the Lord your God has commanded so that you may live long and that it may go well with you in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. Martin Luther, in his large catechism, says, God has exalted the estate of parents above all others, and he has appointed parents to be his representatives on earth. This means that parents deserve to be respected and obeyed despite their shortcomings and failings. Aging parents, too, should be honored and cared for by their adult children. The honor and love that children owe their parents has no expiration date. Why? Because being a parent is a vocation. It is a calling by God. Perhaps one of the simplest ways that we can honor our fathers and mothers is found in Proverbs 1, verses 8 through 9. It says, listen, my son, to your father's instruction, and do not forsake your mother's teaching. They are a garland to grace your head and a chain to adorn your neck. God also calls the parents to be fruitful and multiply. God offers parents some perspective in Psalm 127, verse 3. Here God reminds us that children are a heritage from God, offspring a reward from him. As God's representatives, parents are the most important teachers that their children will ever have. To parents, and especially to fathers, God gives responsibility to raise children in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Look at Ephesians 6:4. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Another translation has, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. God gives children not to please or amuse parents, but that the parents can guide, govern, and teach their children according to God's will. Parents receive some more practical advice in Deuteronomy 6, 6 through 7. It says, "These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up." Basically, all the time, every opportunity you can get, in the car, on the way home from school, on the way to practice, on the way home from music lessons, at the dinner table, before bed, talk about these things. Talk about the commandments that God has given you. Impress them on your children. You know, God uses means, the ordinary stuff of the world, to accomplish heavenly things on earth, to carry out his divine design for life in a fallen world. Do you believe that? Often we don't. Throughout Scripture, we, the church, are referred to as the bride of Christ. And when we fail to trust God, we are like an unfaithful wife. We just don't trust that God will provide. All we can see is what we don't have. All we can see are the situations in our congregations and in our nation and in our own families. All we can see are the problems, the lack of resources, needs that we can't meet, strength that's not enough. We're often ready to give up and go home, to check out and to tune out, to ignore all the hurting, hungry people that God has placed in our paths, and to retreat from our God-given responsibilities. You know, if God were like us, maybe he would just divorce us, separate from us, leave us to our own devices that we might suffer on our own. But you know what? He doesn't. Instead, God loves us. Look at Romans 5, 8. "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." When Amy and I were getting married, it wasn't uncommon to hear it said that marriage is a 50-50 relationship. But you know what? A wise man once told me that the only thing 50-50 in marriage is divorce. To be the husbands and wives that God has called us to be, we have to be 100%. We have to love our spouses the way that Jesus loves us, 100%. Even when they don't deserve it. But you know what? That sounds impossible. You may think, I can't do that. But you know what? It is possible with God. Now, the thing about a sermon like this on family is that you might be feeling convicted right now. If we're honest, none of us have been the husbands, the wives, the fathers, the mothers, the sons and the daughters that God has meant us to be. We have all sinned and fallen short. But that doesn't mean that we can't be. 1 John 1:9 tells us, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." You know what? You can do that right now, right where you're sitting. Confess your sin. He will purify you. Now, maybe this is the first time that you find yourself believing that this is true. If that's the case, please come see me. Come see Pastor Bob. 3 John 1:4 tells us, "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth." As a parent, may this be true for you too, because it's also true of your God, whose image you have been made in. It brings him joy when his children walk in the truth. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your message today, Lord, about the calling that you've called each and every one of us to, our special positions in our families that only we can fill as a husband, as a wife, as a father, as a mother, as a son, as a daughter. But we pray that you will help us, Lord, to be what you have called us to be. Give us the strength and the power. We confess our sins, our shortcomings, Lord, but we know that you will fulfill us, that you will forgive our sins. And Lord, we pray that you will do that today. And help us this week to be what you have called us to be. In your heavenly name, amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts.